is imposing upon the town and the residents. It's going to be a 39% increase on the water meters and what have you in your home, and a 42.1% increase on the fire protection in the town. So to me, that's quite an increase, and I think we ought to take and give it some thought and see if we couldn't do something there. The next one is, I received a letter on the census of 1990. April 1st, 1990 is the census day, and your community here will need some help. If anybody's interested in helping out, they'd appreciate it. You get in touch with the manager, and we'll go from there, and we'll have some announcements on the TV at a later date on the public service announcements. I guess that is about all that I have at this point. And we'll move on to the first item on the agenda. And it's a wetlands ordinance. And we're going to have a public hearing here this evening. And first off, Council Creelman is going to explain the ordinance. And after he explains the ordinance, the manager, Steve Butler, wasn't able to be here tonight, so the manager is going to explain the wetland map. And then I'll have a chance, and we'll open it up to the public. And I have a couple, three ground rules, as I call them, to spell out at that time. And everybody will get a chance to speak. Don't get nervous. Council Creelman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What I would like to do, in similar fashion to last month's council meeting, is I'd like to basically go through the major sections in the Cape Elizabeth Wetlands Ordinance draft. This is draft number 20. And note beforehand that this draft proposal, should it be enacted, will be substituted for the current section 19-3 off in transcribing the document from draft 18 to draft 19. Bottom of page 12 is section 18.4-9, involving the verification of wetland boundaries. Moving on to page 14, are laid before us the conditions attached to special permits. Following that section are the wetlands restoration and creation section 18.4-11. Following that is the non-conforming activities, section 18.4-12. Page 18 and the final page of the document include penalties, abrogation, and interpretation, section 18.4-13, judicial review, 18.4-14, and finally exemptions, section 18.4-15. As I anticipate a variety of opinions this evening, I don't think it will help for me to go into any greater detail at the moment. There are a variety of people here this evening that perhaps can help me in an effort, should we need to address particular areas. My fellow ordinance committee members, Councilors Masterton and Coggeshall, are with me. Chairman of the Planning Board, Marion Guthrie, I see out in the audience. Of course, the town manager is here, and our town attorney is also present. So with that being said, I will return the floor back to our chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Creeman. Now, the manager will briefly throw out a little bit on the wetlands map.
Before the council for adoption at the same time as the wetland ordinance will be a proposed wetland map. This has been prepared over several years utilizing the Conservation Commission as well as the Greater Portland Council of Governments. Really can't do this so everyone sees it, but I think most of the councilors have seen it before. What this map shows is essentially an overlay this here is the base map, and you can see there are several different colors. What the white area shows is essentially areas that are not proposed to be classified as wetlands. The orange areas are the critical wetland zones, and there are certain restrictions that apply within those to be described in the ordinance. The yellow areas are wetland protection zones. There are still standards that would be applied to those areas, but not quite as severe as the critical wetland zones. In addition to the map, there was also work done 5 or 6 years ago by an intern working with the Conservation Commission, and that was to go out and do actual site inspections of where wetlands occur. Those are all the little greenish-blue areas that you see on the map. Those are areas that essentially have wetlands and in most cases more than an acre. I should have mentioned that the yellow and orange areas, that mapping of the soils was done based on the Cumberland County Soil Survey. This, in fact, constitutes the wetland map at this point. However, at the request of the Ordinance Committee, Steve Butler, our planner, also attempted to show the buffer areas that would be impacted through this ordinance. In many areas, there is proposed to be a 250-foot buffer area from the critical wetlands, and in other areas, it's proposed to be 100 feet. Essentially, it's 100 feet in those areas where the topography greatly changes, as well as in densely settled areas. And if you look at all these green lines, that attempts to show the areas where there would be a 250-foot buffer, and it would be a 100-foot buffer. That's the wetlands map proposed.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I need to make one clarification. This evening is going to be the first of two public hearings. so that we will be really asking for your input this evening. The input will be taken back to the Ordinance Committee, and we do anticipate having a second follow-up public hearing on this ordinance, most probably at the February regularly scheduled town council meeting.
Thank you. Now, what I would like, how I'd like to handle this, and I think I'd like to see it go as swiftly as possible, and I want each and every one that wants to speak to come down to the podium, state your name and address, and we're going to take some notes here, and we do have an ordinance committee review of what goes on at this meeting on the 15th of January. And I'd like to have you make your speeches as brief as possible, and if anybody has spoken ahead of you on the same subject, and I know you like to say I agree or something to that effect, just make a brief note of it instead of going back to the whole history as they did previously. And if you can do that, it would be greatly appreciated. Everyone will get a chance to speak. We'll hold no one back from not wanting to speak. What I'd like to see you do is let everyone go through it that wants to speak first, and then if you have a short question or a presentation afterwards, we'll let you have another shot at it. And when we get so we're plowing the same ground over and over, I think I'll probably cut the public hearing off. And no offense to anybody, if you have anybody to criticize, you can criticize me and not the rest of the council. Like Councilor Creamon said, that there'll be another public hearing coming up, possibly the 1st of February if everything is in order. Maybe there'll be enough comment tonight that we might not be able to make that date. If anybody's got any paperwork, any info that they would like to pass on to this council, just one sheet is acceptable, and we'll make copies for the rest and the Ordinance Committee. If after the meeting you have something that you would like to pass on, we'd like to have you get it in here by the end of the week so we could have it at our next Ordinance Committee meeting. It would be greatly helpful if you could do it. So for those few comments, we're ready to go, and who would like to start? Nobody? Yes, Council Maxwell.
I'm hoping to get through so I can get downstairs and vote for the company election.
Vote for me, William.
There you go. My name is Kenneth Maxwell, a farmer in the town of Cape Elizabeth, and the landowner, shall we say. I cannot speak to the technical merits of this thing, but I can share my feelings, and I hope I can get a few points across to you. I have been told that many years ago that town meetings were kept lively by a division between the city slickers and the cabbage farmers, you know, from Cape Cottage to the cabbage farmers, and everyone had different ideas and different ways of going about it. Well, it may be the same today, but I think the odds have kind of changed. So there's very few cabbage farmers left in the town, but I don't know that I want to call you folks all city slickers, but you're certainly increased. So I probably am going to be in the minority here, but I want to share just a few feelings, quick-like. And to start it off, I'm going to be very brutal in that I feel as though that the anti-development feelings in this town is so strong that it is attempting to create a god out of wetlands that makes them untouchable. And to show the proper respect, we must even stay away from these wetlands up to 250 feet. And I believe this is done mostly by a group of people, and forgive me, but this is my feeling, that own their postage stamp lots and want to control the open space within the town. Have I made one point, my feelings? And when I looked at the purpose, and I've only got number 18, so there may be some changes in the last two, I'm not sure. But the purpose of this ordinance, as I read it, is to stop a crippled development and provide free open space near on and near wetlands that the citizens of this town may enjoy for recreation, scientific study, education, etc. The free enjoyment of this area. The paper quoted a gentleman or somebody from Broad Cove who expressed this very clearly, that he enjoyed, he looked forward to the improvement of this because it would allow the town to have open space. That's the viewpoint of it. Agriculture under this ordinance, I would say that in the past, every inch of this town, every inch, was in agriculture at one time. The farmers would cut wood for themselves or to sell. They would till the soil. They would mow the grass to sell it for hay, and they'd even mow the marshland to sell it. And over the past several hundred years, I don't feel as though it's been destroyed too terribly. Now agriculture is going to be allowed by planning board permit. I've been before the planning board a couple of times recently to get permits, and this is not very tasteful to me. I know I'm going to hear the words, "Oh, Ken, you're going to be grandfathered." I know I'm a grandfather, but I don't like that word. I don't like the feeling that I am involved in a business that when I die, they'll be glad to see me go. The attitude or the feeling that if I make one mistake and lose my grandfather clause, and grandfather clauses, and what little I have seen, are very technical and very definite, that if you're caught not doing a certain thing for a period of time, whatever that is, it's nice to feel you are an unwanted business. I have a small pond behind my house. It was a marshland. Now I feel as though it's a very attractive pond. It's in the critical wetland. I have a greenhouse within 30 feet of it. It's mowed, there's ducks in it. And when I look at the restrictions that you want to put around this type of an area, well, it makes me sick. This is a very attractive pond, and I would not be allowed to have created this under this ordinance. It would have to be left in its natural state. My main agricultural field between Spillwink Avenue and Sawyer Road apparently is guilty of destroying the ecology and all the other good things that we enjoy. This was created by draining the field, bulldozing the trees and the stumps, all of this type of activity. Now I have about 50 acres of what I consider pretty good farmland. Illegal today. I have a small backhoe that I have used to clean out ditches, chase woodchucks when they go into the hole, or whatever I want to do with it. I'm going to feel quite unclean just driving the backhoe into that field if I want to really, really live under this ordinance. I have just invested over $200,000 in my agricultural business in this town. And I must confess that the gist of this ordinance gives me second thoughts as to whether this was a wise move. If this ordinance had been in effect when I started farming, I couldn't have done it. There's no way I could have done it at all, because everything that I've done to make those fields and create them and improve them is contrary to this ordinance. I don't think this is what you want, but I think the feeling of controlling development has made you so gun-shy that you want a broad spectrum, and you're sucking in a lot of innocent people in the process. My suggestion to you is decide what you want to do, admit it, and then focus on that point. I haven't helped you much on technicalities, but I've tried to be honest and share my feelings with you. If I can answer any questions, I'll talk to you later. I'll be glad to do it.
Thank you. Anybody got a question? Kenny? Okay, thank you. Who's next?
My name is Larry Clough. I live at 58 Stony Brook Road. I'm probably one of the city slickers, since Stony Brook area is probably the most densely developed part of the town. It was originally subdivided in the early 1900s. But at least the map that I looked at the other morning in Steve Butler's office was a little different than this. And it was about double the scale of this. And the concern I have is that there's a pond on my property that was created in the late 1950s. And on this map, the pond is actually misplaced. It's placed right on the top of my house, which if anyone goes out and looks at the property, it's a 3.5-acre lot. The pond is, in fact, some 150 feet away. So I think, I'm not sure who's responsible for the maps that are being submitted, but I think some further work really needs to be done as far as wetland locations, particularly in a neighborhood like mine where the boundary lines are pretty well defined. It's not 50 acres like Ken Maxwell has. But in my neighborhood, out of the 10 houses that are closest to me, including my own, 7 of these houses are either in wetlands that would qualify as such under the soil and vegetative standards, or within the wetlands map. And this is in the most densely populated area of the town. I have plans, as my house was originally constructed, of constructing an expansion. And to me, because it goes over the 25% of floor area, even though it doesn't expand the footprint of the house, I would be in a situation where you'd have to convince the building inspector that the map was wrong, or else I would have to go to the planning board. And I can't, you know, it doesn't seem to me that, particularly in a neighborhood like the Oakhurst, Stony Brook, Mountain View area, that the scope of the ordinance was really meant to apply so intensely to that area. This is an area that there is a lot of wet area. The concern I have is the way wetland is defined in the ordinance. There's no minimum area that's required for soil. You could have a 10-foot area, and that would fall within the definition of wetlands. And literally speaking, you'd have to go to planning board to be allowed to do almost anything with that land. The exemptions for existing residential and uses are really taken word for word from the existing text of the ordinance and are not responsive to the much greater scope of the new ordinance. The 1,000 square feet of, I think it's landscaping area, if you look at vegetative cutting, I think you could reasonably conclude that cutting your lawn was vegetative cutting. And if your lawn is over 1,000 square feet, it doesn't make sense, but you could literally read this ordinance to say you can't cut your lawn if it's over 1,000 square feet in area. Another difficulty as I have is the wetlands definition is in part a seasonal definition based on the growing season between May 1st and October 1st. This really rules out the balance of the year, which is 7 months of the year, as far as any ability to determine whether land is in fact wetlands or not. The building inspector really couldn't go out on October 15th to see if the area is wetlands, because that falls outside of the growing season. So you'd have a 7-month period of the year in which the town is basically paralyzed from making any decision as to whether land is properly classified or not, because it's not in the growing season. From a somewhat broader perspective, there is no procedure for a variance under this ordinance. It's to be liberally construed. These are the minimum standards. Under our present zoning ordinance, it is possible to get variances from the literal text of the ordinance if it would work a hardship. Here, it's the minimum. That's it. There's no possibility of variation. And I think that's, if you look at this map, there's a very broad area of the town that's affected. Just, you know, I'd say at least 25% of the land area of the town is in some way affected by this ordinance. And you're subjecting people to a pretty tough set of standards, which, and just to take the extreme example, the 10 square feet of wetlands, it may not make any sense to have somebody do a site plan, a topo plan, a stormwater drainage plan, and so forth. And there really should be some capability of the planning board to do away with these requirements in the smaller wetlands area. The definition of critical wetlands, if you read through that and shake out some of the criteria, one of the criteria that allows a wetlands to be a special wetlands is that it has special characteristics. Now, I'm not sure what that means, but that's basically one of the differentials between the most highly protected area and an ordinary wetland. And special characteristics, to me, isn't a very well-defined standard. The last concern that I'll raise is this. I've been on the Comprehensive Plan Commission of the town for a couple of years, and there are a variety of concerns that at least that commission had, and I'm not speaking for the commission, but this, the wetlands concern was one out of basically 40 different areas of a concern that we felt the town should have. And I think this ordinance places wetlands at 10, and some of the other items of concern to the town, such as open space protection for agricultural fields or for the views, that there's really no consideration given to these other concerns, which I think legitimately affect land use policy. You can't just have wetlands be all by itself and ignore some of the farmland protection or the view protection that I think should be a concern of the town. And, you know, municipal use is not an allowed use in the critical wetland zone. You know, if a road washes out in a critical wetlands, before the town can repair the road, the way the ordinance reads, you've literally got to get a planning board permit to repair the road. And that, you know, there needs to be more balance in the ordinance. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody got a comment?
I would have one question.
Just a minute.
Just for clarification again, in terms of how you could expand your house if you wanted to, could you just explain to me again your concern or why you touched upon that? For agreement, is it that you can expand to 25% of the square footage of your present house would be allowed? Is that right?
Well,
or 25% of the house?
As I recall the definition, let me back up. When I built moved 100 yards in 1983 to my present house, and I built it knowing that I wanted to.
The monks have taken the initiative to start a wholesale nursery on the western end of Cape Elizabeth. As you can see, this is the outline of the monks' property. This is the nursery zone. We have currently one permanent greenhouse, a head house, a vehicle shed, and three polyethylene greenhouses. These were built in 1985. We currently have nursery crops growing in these two fields. What the impact of the proposed wetland ordinance does to this land, as you can see, it will cut exactly in half the now conforming use field, nursery crop fields, and make them non-conforming. Use if they fall within the 250-foot wetlands buffer zone or critical wetlands buffer zone will be prohibitive. In addition, any additional structures will be impossible to build. For us to go out and sink additional, we had scheduled to build additional support structures for this nursery. We're an expanding business. We think that the business we're in is a good one. I think it's a good one for Cape Elizabeth. I find it hard to think that growing trees is going to be non-conforming use of the land. In addition, the monks have taken the forethought to outline building sites for their children and their grandchildren, and the future building sites will now be exempt in many cases, and it literally landlocks the property.
Which ones would be existing, which ones are exempt, and which ones are future?
The buildings that are in red are outlined as existing buildings. There's these up at the residential main house. Support buildings for the main house. Future sites are yellow. These have been proposed since 1983. We've taken steps to develop this property in a sequence in an orderly fashion, and we feel that the wetland ordinance is going to tie our hands. I agree with Kenny Maxwell that agricultural use should be conforming use of the land. I feel that the 250-foot buffer, we should have a review process in which we can not only do agriculture in the 250-foot buffer, but also we should be able to build. Not all soils types and vegetation types that border on critical wetlands are critical to those wetlands, and many soils and soil types within 250 feet of the wetland can, in my opinion, can take a lot of impact without disturbing those wetlands. And I think that you would find along this border, especially in our area, that the drop-off is quite great, and the soils vary dramatically between the two zones. And those are pretty much my comments. Is there any questions?
Anybody got a comment? Yes, Counselor Guda.
Building permit, then we were required to get permits.
Who did that mapping for you?
I would have to look into that. I'd gladly do that.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else? Counselor Latore.
Yes, just to clarify, because a lot has been just said within the last 5 minutes, the presentations that you all made. Are you saying that under some circumstances you believe that dwellings should be permitted to be built within a agreed upon critical wetland?
No, within the critical wetland buffer. I feel that there should be a review process, and that if we can prove that there is not significant impact on the critical wetland, that we should be able to build any support structures, especially for the nursery, within those critical
wetland
within the
buffers.
Critical wetland buffers.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Masterson.
I just wondered whether it would be possible if the Ordinance Committee could borrow your map so that we, it's kind of hard for us to see from here, so that we could examine them more carefully.
Yeah.
Don't you think that would be a good idea, Councilor Cleelman?
This is an overlay of the map, pretty much as your map is written.
Yes, we'd be most grateful. We're going to be meeting a week from tonight to review the comments this evening. If we might bar them, as I say, we would be very grateful to you.
Okay. And just to make the agricultural use non-conforming is, I think, in a town like this is going to be a shame.
Anybody else? Thank you. Appreciate it. We can, you could drop them maps off this evening, or maybe you drop them off sometime for Monday, whatever your wishes are. They'll be well taken care of, I'll guarantee you. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, my name is Michael Healy, and I've been the potted plant here for a few moments. I'm an attorney, and I'm representing the Sprague Corporation.
Thank you.
And my office is in Portland, Maine, and I would like to make a few additional brief comments in support of the statements that have been made here tonight. I have some written material, which I do not intend to read, but I will leave to you for distribution, and I have copies for distribution. First of all, a little further background. The Sprague Corporation owns, as I understand it, approximately 2,700 acres of land. And this is a general depiction of all of that land. And these maps have been prepared by John based upon the town's map and the Cumberland County Soil Survey to give us the best indication that we can of what our wetlands on the property as they exist now, so that the corporation could figure out exactly what the impact of your proposed ordinance is on them. As I think you all know, since I understand this is the 20th draft of your ordinance, that the definition of what constitutes a wetland and the determination of exactly where the boundaries are of a wetland as compared to the upland is extremely important for federal law purposes, for state law purposes, and will become extremely important under your ordinance if it's adopted as it's presently drafted. And in the last 2 or 3 years, both the federal and state regulatory processes in reviewing wetlands, determining what are wetlands, and actually mapping those wetlands has become a much more intensive activity. And generally, landowners that particularly are going through the developing process have to hire a wetlands mapper, who is a person skilled and trained in it, to go out on the field and flag the wetlands. And then there's quite an extensive process with both the federal and state agencies in checking that flagging and mapping to agree upon the exact boundaries of a wetland. And that in itself is an expensive and time-consuming process. So this map should not be a statement by Sprague Corporation that these are, in fact, the wetlands on their property. The wetlands may be greater in some instances, and they may be smaller in other instances if a professional person went out there and actually mapped the wetlands. Secondly, since there are federal law and state law, and now your proposed municipal ordinance, there's one thing that we'd hope you would give very serious consideration to, and that is adopting a definition of what constitutes a wetland, which is reasonably consistent with the federal and state definitions, so that any person that's dealing with a wetland and is going through the process will not end up doing wetlands mapping and ending up with different boundaries of wetlands depending upon which ordinance and so forth that you're operating under. In my handout, I gave you the federal law definition of a wetland, and I gave you the state law definition of a wetland. When it comes to actually mapping the wetlands, the federal agencies have produced a very thick volume. It's about that thick. It's a manual. I've referred to it in the memorandum, which is the method by which wetland boundaries are delineated, in which the wetland scientists use in that process. The state, for all practical purposes, has adopted the manual and recognizes that manual, as if it's being followed, as being the correct method for determining a wetland. And it's presently, the DEP is presently considering a regulation to require that that manual be used as a method of determining the wetland. So I would hope that you would at least give consideration, and on page 3 of your ordinance, when you define wetland upland edge, that you at least give some recognition to the determination of the location of that wetland upland edge if one has used the federal manual and has gone out and actually gone on the ground and had a qualified person attempt to map that wetland edge, so that people that are going through this process can at least get the boundaries of their wetlands resolved for federal, state, and municipal law purposes in a consistent fashion. As I'm sure you can understand, having it different is just going to make it more complex and more confusing. Now, that doesn't mean you have to adopt the same regulations. You can have different standards. What we're just saying is what it constitutes a wetland and what the boundary is going to be, try to make it as consistent as you can with state and federal definitions. We consulted with a wetlands mapper, and we're concerned that, in fact, you're going to get substantially different results depending on whether you use the method outlined in your ordinance or the definitions used in your ordinance as compared to the state or federal. The second area that I'd just like to make a brief comment on is the definition of critical wetland zone versus the wetland protection zone. It's very difficult to read the definition of critical wetland zone and the definition of wetland protection zone and try to find out which standard and what is really defining the difference between the two zones. It's clear that if it's designated on the map as a critical wetland, that must assume that it's a wetland, and if it's designated on the map, it's automatically critical. You know, wetlands can be critical, they can be not critical. I'm not sure just drawing a line on the map makes one a critical one or not a critical one. And consequently, A1 doesn't really tell you, other than if someone has drawn it on a map, then it's critical. A2 is quite clear, that can be determined in a reasonably scientific method. A3 is quite clear. A4 is clear. A5 really is a substantial modification, and is very important in this whole scheme, in my view. Under A5, you have determined as a critical wetland any freshwater wetland of 10 acres or more. Now, a freshwater wetland of 10 acres or more, as defined by the state statutes, automatically is designated as a critical wetland. Now, that means for this purpose that this whole area right here, for example, this blue is a critical wetland. This presently is in tree growth and is under active forestry management practices. Under the state law, Sprague Corporation can harvest in there without needing a permit from the DEP, because that's not required under the state law, even though it's in a freshwater wetland. By that, including it in here, you're absolutely prohibiting any timberland operation in that area. Now, the DEP is presently going through a rulemaking proceeding, breaking down the classification of freshwater wetlands into three classes: Class 1, Class 2, and Class 3. Those classes are dependent upon their importance as wetlands. In other words, if it's a very important wetland, it's a Class 1, and what you can do is very restrictive. If it's Class 2, it's less restrictive. If it's Class 3, it's not as restrictive. And by law here, you're automatically, in this particular instance, just saying no timber harvesting there, and just because for state law purposes it's been designated or defined as a freshwater wetland, which all it means under state law is if you were going to fill there, or if you were going to drain it, or if you were going to build structures on it or something of that nature, you would need a permit from the DEP. And that putting in here and having that effect is going quite a ways beyond what the legislature obviously thought was reasonable in terms of what you could or could not do in a freshwater wetland. And, you know, this in fact may be a critical freshwater wetland, and maybe timber harvesting should be reduced or regulated. Maybe a portion of it should not be. But here you're automatically just sweeping it in and making it illegal. The other thing I just want to point out on that is that under the state law, the DEP is required to map all freshwater wetlands and publish maps. And the ordinance is a little unclear as to whether or not the maps produced by the state designating them are the ones that you intend to fall in that category, or is it anything as defined. And I spoke to Mr. Leahy late this afternoon, and he told me it was his understanding that it was anything as defined, not what they had determined in their mapping process. And I think at least what you intend there should be made clear, so we know for sure which way you're going to go. Now, just drawing your attention to page 5, we would request on the use and activity page that you give some consideration, as we understand the ordinance, the critical wetland zone includes the buffer area, and if we come down to item 9, residential buildings and accessory structures, you could not build those in either the critical wetland zone or in the buffer area. And if you can pull these back, you can see which are which, or at least what we think they are. We think that you should allow in that buffer area, with a special permit, residential buildings on a case-by-case basis, depending upon their location and going through the permitting process. Regard to item 13, timber harvesting pursuant to a forestry practice, we think should be allowed in the buffer zone. And I'm going one step beyond my client at this point, but I think that if you're going to include the freshwater wetland 10-acre thing automatically as a critical wetland, that there ought to be some provision for timber harvesting in there on a case-by-case basis. Under item 13, it was unclear to us as to whether or not the last clause, as specifically authorized by the planning board, meant that we could come to the planning board and get permission in the critical wetland zone and the critical buffer to do timber harvesting, or whether that referred only to items 20 and 24. It's a little unclear, and we don't know whether that was intended or not intended. And regarding to item 14, agriculture, again, we think that the in the buffer zone of the critical wetland area, that should be a permitted use. And that these areas that have been used for agriculture should not become non-conforming, essentially illegal uses. On page 9, in the submission requirements, particularly as this relates to agricultural use and timber harvesting use, to require in E, F, and I, that that you have to have a botanist do a study, you have to have a soil scientist do a study, and you have to have an engineer do a study for that type of use, because Sprague Corporation does try to make those uses, the timber and the agricultural self-sustaining, that can become quite expensive. On page 11, and this is in the area of the wetland buffers. Again, subsection 1 criteria, A, small 2, you begin picked up all freshwater wetlands of 10 acres or more. And, of course, that's important because from that edge, you're also adding the buffer zone. And we would just ask you to give some thought as to whether you really want to protect all of the 10 acres and then add a buffer zone on the outside of it. We obviously are concerned about the standards on page 12 dealing with what can be done in the buffer zone, but we've already made our comments on what we think should be allowed. On the verification of the wetland boundaries, we would hope that there would be a process and a procedure whereby a landowner could have their lands mapped for wetlands for all purposes, state, federal, and local, determine what the boundaries of those wetlands are and not rely upon what can many times be inaccurate overlay soils maps, and be able to present that to the federal government, the state government, and the town government, and get a determination from a knowledgeable person that that boundary has been correctly mapped, and once that determination is made, have us know that we know that's where the edge of the wetland boundary is. That's important for two reasons. One is, if you go through the expensive process of doing the mapping, you want to know that the agencies that are going to be reviewing it agree that that's correct. And number two, for your own internal use, that you make sure that you don't inadvertently fill a wetland to do something, someone does something without knowing that they're actually dealing with a wetland. And as a general proposition, we found, or at least we believed upon reading this, that this process of actually determining the boundary of a wetland was quite cumbersome with many committees involved, the Conservation Commission involved, the Planning Board involved, the Code Enforcement Officer involved, and ultimately they may all should have input in it and be able to have a review, but there ought to be some process that they should only get involved if there's really a serious dispute as to what constitutes the wetland. And I'll have a few other comments, but in view of the time we've taken, I'll defer and answer any questions.
Thank you. Anybody got a comment? Councilor Mass.
Michael, I'm interested in the state's defining critical areas in wetlands in classes. Has this been because of pressure from landowners or from paper companies or what? Is this a trend?
Well, I'm not involved. There's a rulemaking process going on now with the DEP.
Well, that's what I'm trying to find out about.
Yeah, and
how
I can.
How likely are these classes to survive?
I don't know. I'm not involved in the rulemaking process, so I really don't know what's going on and who's asking for what and why and so forth. But my understanding that the rulemaking process was initiated by the DEP in order to give them some more predictable method of dealing with the wetland issue that arises in front of them and is arising much more frequently now that the legislature has expanded the definition to include the 10-acre freshwater wetland, which can you know, include things that, you know, someone might call a not a bog or a swamp, but it's wet, but there are trees that are growing there. And my understanding is the DEP is trying to basically say the ones that are really critical by the function of the wetland, as determined by the function of the wetland, we will protect. Those that are mediumly critical, we will be more flexible with, and those that may fall within the definition of a freshwater wetland, but are not functionally important, we are not going to be so tough with, and people can fill in they can undertake activities there and will be able to get permits for doing so.
I think it's a good concept.
And I can give you a copy of
the, I would like to see a copy of the state regs.
I'll leave one here tonight.
I read about them in the paper.
Yeah.
Does this concept of classes come out of the federal manual?
I don't know the answer to that. You'd have to ask a wetland scientist.
We're sort of in a bind because of where those state regs are right now. It's difficult to be consistent with the regs, right?
Well, it could be difficult to be consistent with the regs, but the regs are going to be, I know that they've gone through two or three redrafts, and all I can say is that when you have such an area as this being classified as a freshwater wetland, which I don't know the acreage there, but it's quite a bit, and you take the state definition and then you transport it into this ordinance and then you put all those prohibitions on it, you're going a lot further than the state statute does in determining what can and cannot be done in that freshwater wetland. You have taken that one giant step down the road, and if you're going to do that by defining it as a critical wetland, then you ought to be very sure that it really is a critical wetland, and if it is, you ought to exercise your authority and you know, protect it.
We realize that there are problems with this 20th draft of critical of the wetlands ordinance. We realize there are problems. That's why we're having this hearing tonight.
Yeah.
To listen to complaints.
Yeah. Well, I'm a little.
Praise.
I apologize for coming in on the 20th draft because I know how much work goes into trying to do these things.
And it hasn't all been the ordinance committee. It's yeah. been the planning board and numerous other people in town. So
yeah.
Thank you for your comments.
And we'd be happy to leave the maps, and if
you'll send me the state proposed.
I'll leave it. I have it in my file over here.
Okay.
I'll leave it here tonight.
Is anybody?
And if you'd like Mr. Green to come to the meeting to go over these maps with you, we'd be happy to, so that if he needs any explanation, he'd be happy to do so.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Greenlaw.
I have a question on your state definition of freshwater wetlands. How current is this definition to your knowledge?
It's right out of the statute book as it exists today.
I have a state definition approved June 22nd, 1989 that differs from this. I'm wondering if yours is more current, perhaps.
Well, I'll have to check it and see. I believe this is the current one, but I'll double check it to make sure.
My concern is I think you bring up a very valid point that the definitions on all levels should coincide. And I do want to make sure that it's, we're as up to date and accurate as possible. What I'm looking at has state definition quite accurately coinciding with the federal definition.
Okay. Now, you have to be careful when you...
And our lawyer and our planner to look into that, make sure we've got the most up-to-date one.
All right. You have to understand there's more than one state definition, too.
Mm-hmm.
There are actually three. There's one in the state subdivision law, and then there's one in the Natural Resource Protection Act, which is the one I intend to quote, and then there's another one which I refer to. They're not all exactly the same, but they are at least close enough not to spend a lot of time arguing about the
I know that that something was wrong with that ordinance. And I feel very sorry for the people who will buy these houses, who will live in these wetlands buffer zones. I don't feel sorry for the speculators who will lose some money because they're going to lose X number of lots. They have a very tangible argument. They can get up here and say, I've got so many lots, I'm going to lose this. I can't do that. Thousands of people in the town who live on the postage stamp spot, then their argument is not going to be as easy to make. And I think this ordinance is for them. I don't think we should forget that. I think we should end construction on marginal soils. We saw a house down the street from us built this past summer after the lot was for sale for 2 or 3 years and nobody would touch it because it was wet. And finally they decide, well, we'll build on speculation, fill it all in, nobody will see what's going on. And it was education and underwater construction for the entire neighborhood. And the minute they dug the foundation hole, it filled right in. The next step was to bring in pumps. So they tried to pump out the foundation hole. That didn't work, so they poured the foundation underwater. Everybody in the neighborhood wanted to see that, so they put up plywood on the casement windows so people wouldn't peek in and see what the water level was doing that day. Today, the house is all built. Every once in a while, we see parked in the driveway basement ceiling service trucks.